in the research in options 2017. And this fourth mini course is going to be delivered by Dr. Julien Guillaume. And he's going to talk about the particle method for smile calibration. Julien, merci.
Thank you very much, George, for the invitation and for organizing such a nice conference. It's always a pleasure to be back in Rio and at IMPA. Thank you, everyone, for being here, especially on a Sunday afternoon, to hear about a very nice numerical method that is extremely useful and actually that's the state of the art for the calibration of models to market smiles. Okay, it's called the particle method. I must say that it's probably so far the best scientific surprise of my life, because you know sometimes you have like good ideas, but the numerical method will be maybe very slow, or maybe it's fast but it's not so accurate. And actually, this one turns out to be like at the, both very accurate and very fast. Okay, so I'll try to convince you of the usefulness and the robustness and all the possibilities offered by the particle method. Okay, so I'm a quant at Bloomberg in New York, and also an adjunct prof at Columbia and NYU. And part of the results that I will present, that's bad. I have to change the. Are joint work with Pierre-Henri Labordère, okay, from Société Générale, my ex-colleague and friend. How do I go back? I just want to change the.
Do you need to put the.
I'm supposed to go back, but I don't know how I can go back from this window. God. Attends, let me quit and then. Ah, yeah, okay. Okay. Ah, c'est économiseur. Doesn't it like 20 minutes, like 1 hour? No, it's screen saver options. Maybe c'est ça, non? Yeah.
Voilà, c'est ça. Yeah. Alors non, c'est pas ça. Il faut mettre que ça, c'est dans l'économiseur, t'es dans l'économiseur, là, c'est ça?
Ouais. Voilà, ensuite, tu peux retourner en screen saver.
Est-ce qu'il est l'économiseur? Non, j'y sais rien.
Ah, yeah. Mais never. Jamais. Okay. Okay. Yeah. So this is also joint work with Gilles Pagès, who is helping a lot. Thank you, Gilles. Oh yeah, I have to go back to the slide. Sorry. Thank you, Gilles. Okay. You can expect for at least another technical problem in the next 5 minutes, but not many more than that. Okay. So I was saying that it's partly joint work with Pierre-Henri Labordère from Société Générale. I was at SocGen for 6 years, a colleague of Pierre. Okay. So just a few words to tell you where our contribution fits in the literature. So the particle method, okay, is actually just one numerical way of approaching the solutions to nonlinear stochastic differential equations. Okay, they were introduced by Henry McKean in 1966 in this seminal paper, a class of Markov processes associated with nonlinear parabolic equations. It is linked to what Katz has coined propagation of chaos, okay, related to a gas theory in at the beginning of the 60s. Okay, so the particle method has been introduced by Snitman and then developed by many people, including Meillard, Chorin, Puckett, Talley, Bossi, Jourdain, and others. I'm sorry if I forgot some people in the room or colleagues. And so our contribution is to apply this particle method to a variety of smile calibration problems in finance. So basically, when you want, you have your model, okay? Say, for instance, stochastic volatility model, okay, for your market, and you want your model to be calibrated to the prices of vanilla options. Okay. So I will first deal with single asset models, okay? So basically taking first the example of stochastic local volatility models, introducing McKean stochastic differential equations and the particle method, explaining how you can make it efficient, that means make it fast, and I will insist on the robustness of the particle method, meaning that you can have several factors driving your stochastic volatility model, or you may have stochastic interest rates, or you may have stochastic dividend yield, okay, or repo. No problem, the particle method will easily handle it, and this is contrary to the PD method, okay, or the use of finite difference solvers that cannot typically easily adapt to many sources of randomness. And you can also handle like path dependency, like models where the volatility or other quantities, dynamic quantities, are path dependent. Same thing, the particle method will easily adapt to those models. And then I will, in the second part of the course, of the lecture, I will address the question of multi-asset models, okay? In particular, focusing on local correlation models, and also what I have coined cross-dependent volatility models, which is actually the multi-asset version of path-dependent volatility. And in the last and third part, I will just say some words about the theory, okay, so really the theory of McKean SDs and the propagation of chaos. And actually in the very last part, because I think like everybody will be bored, especially on a Sunday afternoon, after 2.5 hours of particle method, maybe I will just, if you are okay, talk a little bit about the final draw of the World Cup that is going to happen on Friday, just to show you some fun probabilities. Okay, of course, not related at all with the particle method. Okay, so let's start with a simple problem, which is that's the really basic problem for smile calibration, which is calibration of a stochastic local volatility model to a market smile, and then I'll extend to a path-dependent volatility. So first, I mean, why use stochastic volatility models? Well, you know that exotic options or path-dependent options, they bear risks that are, for instance, risk of volatility, or risk or correlation between spot and volatility, or the risk of forward smile. Okay, and if you want to have a control on those risks, you should certainly not use the Black-Scholes model, because it gives you absolutely no control on that. Or also the local volatility model, because the local volatility model has no free parameter for those risks, right? So rather, you would be happy to use a stochastic volatility model, where the stochastic volatility AT is a random process, okay, typically an Itô diffusion, but not necessarily. So common examples are the Heston model, or the Saber model, or double log normal model. And they have parameters, typically vol-of-vol, spot-vol correlation, mean reversion, that allow you to control, okay, those exotic risks. Okay, so you're happy using a stochastic volatility model. And we know that stochastic volatility models, they do produce a smile of implied volatility. So when I say smile, it's like the whole surface of implied volatilities. And this goes back to seminal papers by Alan White, Renaud and Tuzzi in the 90s. Okay. With Lorenzo Bergomi at Société Générale, we have actually developed a systematic analysis of the smile in pure stochastic volatility models that gives you exactly the smile at order two in vol-of-vol and the link between spot-vol correlation and vol-vol correlation. So that's quite well-known today. But because those stochastic volatility models, they have a finite number of parameters, okay, vol-of-vol, spot-vol correlation, mean reversion, okay. Sometimes they can have more than three, they can have maybe 5, 10 parameters, but still a finite and quite small number of parameters. With just those even 10 parameters, you will never be able to fit exactly the market smile of implied volatility, the full surface of implied volatilities for all strikes and all maturities. Okay, you don't have enough degrees of freedom to do that. Okay, so I'm not saying that it's always a good idea to fit to the vanilla smile. Sometimes if you have to price and hedge an option whose risks are almost orthogonal to the vanilla risk, meaning that basically if the fact that you hedge with vanilla options, your exotic option, does not decrease or only marginally decreases the variance of your hedged PNL, okay? In that case, it's completely useless and it would be a bad idea to calibrate your model to vanilla smiles, because anyway, the vanilla smiles would be useless for your hedge. But it actually happens that most of the time, most exotic options, they are actually quite well hedged by a portfolio of vanilla options. And so if your model is calibrated to the prices of vanilla options, that means that it incorporates the correct price of the hedging instruments, okay, that you will use to hedge your exotic options. And that's why I think in almost all trading desks, okay, in the industry, and that's also a requirement from the risk departments, that they require that the models be calibrated to the liquid quotes, which are the quotes of vanilla options, typically. Okay. So now the question is, you want to use the stochastic volatility model because of the nice dynamics of joint dynamics of spot and implied volatilities that it produces, but at the same time, you want to be calibrated exactly to the vanilla options, okay, and you don't have enough degrees of freedom. So what you do is you will add degrees of freedom in the form of this local volatility component, okay, so it's just a function sigma of time and current spot, so it's a local volatility component, but that's not the local volatility of the market, the one that you compute using the Dupierre formula. Okay, it's different, this one is different, it's just a small decoration on top of your stochastic volatility A. Okay? And you see that because we are introducing this function of time and spot, so it has it's like a double infinity of parameters. We are in a good position to calibrate the full surface of implied volatilities indexed by maturities and strikes, because you have the same number of parameters, from double infinity of parameters, double infinity of constraints, if you want. That's not a proof, but at least that's the idea why it could work. And in this case, we speak of stochastic local volatility models, okay, when volatility is a product of stochastic vol A and a leverage. So this function sigma is called the leverage function, okay, leverage function or stochastic volatility, sorry, local volatility component, but I will mainly use the word leverage function. Okay, so the main issue that we are addressing today in this lecture is how do you, once you have decided the parameters for your stochastic volatility model that you like, for the nice dynamic properties of the stochastic volatility model, how can you build the function sigma so that it calibrates exactly to the vanilla smile? Again, imagine that if I stress that sigma is not the Dupierre local volatility, because if, for instance, you start from a stochastic volatility model A that produces a smile that is already very close to the market smile, you actually expect this leverage function sigma to be around one, okay? Because the most part of the job would have already been done by the stochastic volatility. Okay, so that's here the necessary and sufficient condition for the stochastic local volatility model to be calibrated to the market smile. So here, I'm assuming deterministic rate R and dividend yield Q inclusive of the repo. Looking at a stochastic local volatility model with any stochastic volatility model A. And we will prove in a few slides that this model is exactly calibrated to the market smile of S if and only if this condition holds. Okay? It's telling you that you're taking the conditional expectation of the instantaneous variance of S. So you see that the instantaneous variance of S is sigma squared times A squared. Okay? And you take the conditional expectation of this given the level of the spot, say k. Of course, because it's given S is equal to k, then the sigma of TST becomes sigma of TK and can go out of the conditional expectation. Okay? So this is the conditional expectation of the instantaneous variance given ST is equal to k. And this has to be equal to the Dupuy local volatility square, so the local volatility of your market square. Okay. So again, and it's a necessary and sufficient condition. Okay. So you need to have this condition, and if you have it, then the model is calibrated to the market smile. So again, it's just you're looking at instantaneous variance. Of course, if A is always equals to 1, for instance, okay, so that means that the only function sigma that works is the local volatility. That's fine. But in general, what you have to do is you have to project all the instantaneous variances on the spot value, and this has to be equal to the local variance, okay, so the square of the local volatility. Okay. So that's maybe the most important use. Why local volatility is so useful is because of this condition. Not that nobody believes that markets behave according to the local volatility model, but still the local volatility appears, you know, as a crucial ingredient when you want to calibrate to the vanilla smile any model through this condition. Okay, what does it mean? It means it's actually quite easy, because remember that we give ourselves the parameters for the stochastic volatility and we want to build sigma. Well, but then sigma, it's easy. Sigma, you can back out sigma easily from this condition. Sigma is just local volatility divided by the square root of this conditional expectation. Okay? And so I can replace the leverage function by this local volatility divided by the square root of the conditional expectation in the dynamics. So that's the dynamics of the calibrated model. But you see that this is actually a complicated dynamics, because this quantity here, the conditional expectation, it depends on the joint distribution of ST and AT. Okay? But ST and AT, ST, you know, is solution to this equation. Okay? So if you want here, the diffusion coefficient depends on the joint probability density function of ST and AT. So that's exactly what is called the Mackin stochastic differential equation, where the coefficients of the diffusion are allowed to depend on the marginal distribution of the process itself. So for traditional SDEs, so the coefficients do not depend on the marginal law; it just depends on the location. XT, okay, and so we know that the PDF of X is solution to the forward equation, which is the Fokker-Planck PDE, okay, which is written here. And the PDE, okay, is linear in P, that's a linear PDE, okay, and so that's why some people speak of linear SDEs. And we know the classical results of existence and uniqueness, okay, based on Lipschitz or local Lipschitz conditions. For Mackin SDEs, okay, do we have equivalent results? So for Mackin SDEs, in general, you have an X which is in dimension n, for instance, and you see that your diffusion X, the coefficients may depend on PT, which is the marginal distribution of your process X, which is unknown. You don't know PT, no, it's part of the solution.
So for in the example of the stochastic local volatility model, if you imagine that A is driven by just one Brownian motion, we would be in dimension 2, and our process X would be the spot, comma, the stochastic volatility. Okay? And if you know the joint distribution of S and A, then you are able to compute the conditional expectation that appears in the diffusion coefficient. And so, indeed, the calibrated model follows a McKean SDE. Actually, you can prove, and it works the same as for classical SDEs, that the PDF of X is solution also to the same Fokker-Planck PDE. It's exactly the same as before, except that now the coefficients, you see B and sigma, so drift and diffusion coefficient, they do depend on the marginal distribution P. Okay, so here would be the density small p. So you see that P, which is the unknown in this PDE, is here, but is also here as an argument of the coefficients. So that means that now this is a nonlinear PDE, and that's why we speak of nonlinear stochastic differential equations for those McKean SDEs. Okay? The term nonlinear comes from the fact that the associated Fokker-Planck PDE is nonlinear. And uniqueness and existence results have been proved by Snitman, Meleard, Jourdain, others. If drift and volatility coefficients are Lipschitz continuous functions of the marginal distribution, okay, so you need a distance on distributions, and this is with respect to the Wasserstein metric. Okay, so those results have already been established. So just a reminder here on the Monge-Kantorowicz distance, okay, or Wasserstein metric. That corresponds to the optimal transport from measure P1 to measure P2, okay, according to the cost function, which is just the distance here to the power P. Okay, so you look at all the margin, all the joint distributions with marginals P1 and P2, and you take the infimum of the cost of moving from P1 to P2. It has a clear financial interpretation, for instance, in dimension 1. If you consider two assets, X and Y, and a payoff, which is the distance to X and Y to the power P, actually, a model tau, okay, is calibrated to the vanilla options on the first asset and the second asset if and only if the marginal distribution of tau are given by the risk-neutral distributions, P1 and P2, that are given by the prices of vanilla options for that maturity for the two assets. Okay, so this means that you're calibrated to the vanilla options on each of the two assets, and then the pricing model here would pick the joint distribution tau that minimizes the fair value of this option. Okay, so that would be a lower bound, okay, on the payoff that pays the distance x to y to the power p, subject to the fact that the model must reprice correctly the vanillas on S1 and the vanillas on S2 maturity cap t. Okay, so that's precisely the Monge-Kantorowicz distance between P1 and P2. Okay, so that's the seminal paper by Henry McKean, who, by the way, I invited when I gave a talk on the subject. It was already, like, I think 3 years ago at NYU, because he's still around, and I was like, maybe he's...
For a long time, I see him every day.
Yeah, he's here. Huh? Yeah. And it's true. So, I thought that maybe he would be happy to see what people do with tools that he and concepts that he invented like 50 years ago, you know, in completely different context or whatever.
Just for the record, he was here about 10 years ago at the birth commemoration of Alberto Grunbaum, who was his student.
Okay.
So Alberto Grunbaum had, we celebrated his 65th birthday here at IMPA about 10 years ago, and McKean came to my talk.
Yeah, fantastic. And so he actually did not answer my email. Well, that's okay. But actually, when I arrived in the room, he was like sitting in the front row and asking like questions that I was not able to answer. And then having drinks, you know, standing for like almost 2 hours, drinking good red wine and being super sharp. I mean, it was already, I think, 83 at the time, so today maybe 86. I was really impressed. Okay. And okay, so that's his seminal paper, 66. It's just like, I mean, four pages paper or five pages paper. And you see just immediately on page two, what you see here, blah, blah, blah. Roughly speaking, the transition mechanism depends upon T via the distribution U, okay, P, the distribution, so that's the marginal distribution only, okay? So here he's considering like the particular case where it does not depend on the distribution of the whole path or the whole process, but only through the current, the marginal distribution, okay? And that's exactly this, those McKinney equations. Okay, so I'm going to present a general theorem about like smile calibration in the next slide. That is more general than the one I just presented because it will allow the rates to be stochastic, the dividend yield to be stochastic, the volatility to be not only a stochastic vol but path-dependent vol, whatever. Okay, and you will see in the theorem I will use R naught, which is a deterministic interest rate, and Q naught, which is a deterministic dividend yield, if you want. It's just I don't have to do it this way. But if I use those references, deterministic interest rate, deterministic repo rate, or dividend yield, then I can use the local volatility that is computed from those deterministic rates, and that makes the formula nicer, I think. So that's why I use it. Of course, a natural way to choose the deterministic rate is directly from the prices of zero coupon bond that you observe, and then you infer the deterministic rate, that rate curve that's consistent with those zero coupons. And once you have the deterministic rates, then you can infer the deterministic dividend yield from the forward curve and the rates. Okay, so that would be the natural R naught and Q naught, but still the result is okay for any Q naught and R naught that you pick. Okay, so that's the result. You consider a very general model where rates can be stochastic, dividend yield can be stochastic, alpha can be also very general, can be path dependent, those can be path dependent as well, everything can be path dependent. They just need to be adapted to some filtration that you chose in the beginning. Okay. But you see there is no jump in the spot, okay, that's important. It's a continuous model on the spot. But the alpha t, the r, q, they can jump, okay, but the spot itself cannot jump. And then I claim that this model is exactly calibrated to the Market Smile of S if and only if you have this condition 7. Okay. You see that, first the rates are stochastic, so you have those stochastic discount factors that are here, d, 0, t, so that's just discounting from time t to time 0. So that's just this negative exponential. Okay. And you have, on top of the local variance that is here, you have two extra terms that involve unconditional expectations. Okay. So this one is about rates, it's R minus Q, indicator that the spot is greater than some strike. And this one is about dividend yield times the call payoff. And of course, I have, so here the fact you see that I actually remove, when I have R minus Q, I remove the deterministic counterpart. When I have Q, I remove the deterministic counterpart. And that allows me to write the equation using this local volatility here. That is precisely the local volatility that is computed using those particular deterministic rates. So I could have presented the results differently, but the fact that I present it this way with the local volatility here means that you can easily check that the formula is consistent with the one that I have given before for deterministic rates and dividend yields. For instance, if the rates and dividends are deterministic, then of course I will take R naught to be R and Q naught to be Q. So this vanishes. This vanishes, okay? The d0t here is just deterministic, so it also simplifies here in the numerator and the denominator, and you're just left with the conditional expectation of alpha t squared given the spot is equal to the local variance, which is exactly the result that I showed before. Okay. So in the more general case where everything is stochastic, you have those conditions here. But you see, this is So this is just the slide on the particular case where rates and dividends are deterministic. So in particular, you see that you have this condition. So if you pick your volatility process alpha t to be some process at, like stochastic, times a function of t and st, of course, that condition becomes this one. And that's why you can back out the sigma from the conditional expectation. Okay, so the fact that you use this particular form where alpha t, the stochastic vol, like the global vol, like the total vol, is some stochastic process A times a function that is just a function of time and spot, current time and current spot, allows you to have easy access to a sigma, to that function, provided the model is calibrated to the market span. And of course, you can do the same here, meaning that if you take alpha t to be some at times a leverage function sigma of tst, you will have an expression, an easy expression for sigma of tst, because it would go out of this conditional expectation. So sigma of t and k would be given as a function of the local volatility and all those here conditional expectations and here unconditional expectations. But in all cases, you see, it will just all those unconditional expectations and conditional expectations, you will be able to compute them if you know the marginal distribution of all the stochastic processes that are involved. So the AT, ST, RT, QT. So it will always be in the McKean form. So the dynamics for the calibrated model will always you will always be able to write them in the McKean form, okay? And so you will be able to use the particle method that I will soon introduce. Very quickly, just for you to have an idea, the proof of the general theorem is simply an application of the Ito-Tanaka formula to the discounted payoff of the call option. So you look at the payoff of the call option, ST minus K plus, you discount it, okay? I call this calligraphic P, okay? And then I look at the differential of this calligraphic P, okay? And I go, it's just Ito formula. Actually, it's Ito Tanaka, okay? I write it like as a physicist would do, okay? With the Dirac mass, but of course you can make it all mathematically rigorous, okay? And if you take the conditional, the expectation on both sides, okay, you get this equality that links the price of the call in the model with those expectations here. And then the trick is so it's actually very similar to the derivation of the Dupierre PDE, actually. And then you want to make a link between those expectations here and the price of the call in the model. Okay, and those so it's very similar to the derivation of the Dupierre formula. We know that when you differentiate the call price in the model with respect to the strike, you get this, the negative of this expectation. If you differentiate another time with respect to the strike, you get this one, which is typically the discounted density of the spot at strike k. And so that means that this previous equation that I have here, I had dtcm here, and now I will have dk and d2k on the right-hand side, which means that I'm actually getting a PDE for the call price in the model. Okay, so you can do the math here. You can have a look at the slides if you want after. It's actually pretty simple. What can we conclude? If we know that the model is calibrated, let me denote by C the price of the call observed in the market. Okay, and so CM is the price of the call in the model. If I assume that my model is calibrated to the market smile, then CM is equal to C. Okay, because CM satisfies this PDE, then C satisfies this PDE. Now, if C satisfies this PDE, again, C are the observed call prices. If I observed, I have interpolated, extrapolated to get a full surface. If C satisfies this PDE, then by uniqueness, because I know that CM satisfies the same PDE with the same initial condition, by uniqueness of a solution to that PDE, I can conclude that C is equal to CM, and so my model is calibrated to the market smile. Okay, so that's how you would you prove that. Okay. Yeah, sure.
I have a small question.
Sure.
Slide.
Okay.
Sorry, George.
Yeah, but so I probably had the same question.
For amateurs like me, take away RQ, make them all equal to zero.
Sure, yeah.
So then what you get is a parabolic equation, time derivative of call price equals time 1/2 k squared times second derivative times this stuff. But we know somewhere that the Dupuy equation would be that, but with a volatility missing. So where's the volatility? It's that ratio is the volatility?
Yeah, that's it. That's the volatility here.
That ratio of the two expectations is the volatility.
Exactly. So if you assume that alpha t is just a function of small t and s t, like in the local volatility model, and you have no discount.
Or maybe if it's a stochastic process, that ratio should be the stochastic volatility.
That's the
local volatility.
Exactly, that's the local.
That ratio is a local volatility.
Exactly, that's the local volatility.
And so this equation is what should...
That's the local volatility.
Yeah.
That's the local volatility. Yeah.
Now the equation above that is an equation for model. So you want to be able to have a model, an alpha, so that...
Yeah.
The equation.
This is equal to the
exactly,
and that's why
so right now
you will get that condition exactly.
So we're looking for alpha.
Yeah. I agree with you that actually maybe for
I didn't make any statement. I just want to find out.
No, but you're right that actually I'm realizing that maybe for pedagogical purposes maybe I should do the proof like in
without
the case
RQ.
Where R is your Q because
don't help.
I agree. Maybe
they're,
I just want to show off.
They're not helping us.
But you got it. That's exactly that. So, no, that's true. That's better. So when you don't have, RQ is zero, so you don't have this anymore. You just have that. And we know in the model that we have that. This is the, we know from the Dupuy equation that this is the sigma log squared. So we just want a model such that this is equal to the sigma log squared, which is exactly what you said.
So just a follow-up of Marco's question. So you in the top part, you have actually the model. And in a certain moment, I heard you saying you don't need interpolation, extrapolation. Can you elaborate on that?
Bit? So the thing is, because I said, C are the call prices observed in the market.
So C, not CM? Or
C, CM? C. Yeah, C is observed in the market, and C, that's the problem because M could be for model or for market, I agree. Actually, here it's for model. So that's the call option in the model. So this M here is for the model, and the C would just be the observed in the market.
What Julien is saying is the top equation is an equation. If you have a model with alpha, then the call price of the model satisfies that P. What you want is that CM is equal to C. So you have to change alpha.
Yes, so I follow. Yeah, but my question then is, what to make up of the fact that in practice you don't have the data all over the surface?
Yeah, exactly. So here you see, I can, I can derive the calibration condition in a way that will allow me to get rid of any optimization routine, which is remarkable. But for this, I need the full surface. If you just, because of course in the market, I will observe prices for a finite number of strikes and a finite number of majorities. That's true. If I decide to just work with those data, I will never be able to write down a condition like this one, okay? Because And it's the fact that I have interpolated and extrapolated all the call option prices that allows me to work with a continuum of strikes and maturities. And in that case, I can exactly write down the exact function sigma that will calibrate perfectly to the market span. But if I, it's much more complicated if I do not allow me to interpolate and extrapolate. But I agree with you that people may argue that, okay, and that's true, that then the results that I get will depend on how I have interpolated and extrapolated.
Yeah. That was actually that where is clear. I was going to lead.
That's correct. That's correct.
Yeah. And what baffles me a little bit is that you have a new post problem. I mean, what you make of the fact that this problem is not well posed, and therefore you have, in principle, not only infinitely many solutions. That's okay because you are fitting your data to something that's infinite dimensional anyway. So your parameter is infinite dimensional, your data is finite. But the problem is that it's not a well-posed problem. So anyway, when you start to interpolate, the way you interpolate is going to heavily bias your final solution.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. But okay. So
I have not worked on this. I know that you have worked a lot on the topic. So yeah.
Yeah. No, that's a point we.
No. But that's completely correct. Yeah. I'm aware of this ill-posedness issue.
Yeah.
But here, I just want to make it clear that all this would not be possible if you just work with like the real market data, not interpolated, not extrapolated. But the beauty of it is then you can calibrate without optimizing, which is remarkable, because usually, you want to calibrate to a market, then you have your parameters, you take the sum of the squares of the differences of prices in your model and prices in the market, and blah, blah, blah. That's fine, but then it's unclear what you do. Here, you don't even have to do that. I mean, you'll see, it's almost magical. But I agree that you first have to interpret it. Okay, so any other questions? No? Okay. So let me go to the particle method this time. So that's the main subject of today's lecture. So the numerical approximation of those Mackin SDEs, because we need to, now we want to simulate the calibrated model, so we need to be able to estimate, to simulate it numerically. And so let's see how we can do it. So now, the Mackin SDE, it's easy to simulate a classical stochastic differential equations where you don't have the P here. Okay, because if you have been able to simulate up to time T, you know the position XT of your particle. Okay, you want to simulate up to T plus delta T. Okay, or you just simulate your Brownian increment between T and T plus delta T. And you know exactly the B and the sigma, and so that's okay. That's easy. You do. Okay, but now you see that you have this PT here. So that's the marginal distribution of X at time T. Okay. So for instance, imagine that your Monte Carlo path. So you will see. When I say particle, it's just going to be a path, Monte Carlo path. I'll explain this later. Okay. So you have your path number one that's here. Okay. For instance, path number two that's here. How do you, and imagine that you have, so this is the snapshot at time t, so imagine you have been able to simulate those, 1,000 points up to time t, and you want to go to t plus delta t, okay? So you know for particle number one, x1 is here, so x1, that's fine, here. But you need to have at least an estimation of pt, so the marginal distribution of x, in order to be able to simulate up to t plus delta t, okay? So given like that particular example, maybe the density of x at time t is something by model like this. I don't know, but how can I have access to a good estimation of this p at time t? Well, the best you can do just based on those n points, the n path that you have simulated, is just to look at the empirical distribution of your process x at time n, at time t, sorry. So this is just a sum of Dirac masses, okay, one Dirac mass for each particle, and you just weight by 1 over the number of particles, okay? So that's how I will estimate the marginal distribution at time t, because I have my 1,000 path, So of course, I can have this estimation of the probability density function of x at time t, given those 1,000 paths. Somehow, that's the best I can do, okay, just based on those 1,000 paths. So it seems very crude, okay, but it works really well, and that's exactly the particle method. So you see, in principle, it's very simple, and you will see as well that in practice, it's also very simple, because I'll give you like just a few recipes to make it work super efficiently in practice. So the principle of the particle method is simply in the McKean SDE, you will replace the marginal distribution PT by the empirical distribution. Okay? Okay, but so what are those XIN? Okay. Those XINs, because I need to have been able to simulate up to time T. Okay? So those XINs are precisely the solution to the higher dimensional classical SDE. Okay? So that means that you have say, n path, so I call them again particles. Okay? And if you look at the vector xt, which is made of x1t, so that's the first path, first particle, x2t, okay, up to xnt. Okay. Each of the x's is in dimension small n, say 1 for simplicity. Okay. And then now you're in dimension capital N. Okay. But you see that the dxt here, so the differential of this big vector here, is actually a classical SD. Because the component I, dxi, okay, is like just the btxi and the empirical distribution, and same for the diffusion coefficient. But you see that this empirical distribution, it depends on x1, x2, up to xn, so this whole vector x, because the empirical distribution is just a function of all the locations of all your path. So that means that if you look at x as a whole, this x satisfies a classical SD, where you just have b, where you have dxt, is some b of t xt dt plus sigma t xt dwt. Right? And so that's well defined, I mean, in a classical way. And so then you can define the particle method in this way. And you see that those xi are interacting with each other. So the dynamics for x1, for instance, will depend not only on x1, but also on x2, x3, and all the others through the empirical distribution. Okay? And so you see that the Monte Carlo paths are interacting with each other. And that's why we speak of particles, okay, using an analogy with statistical physics. Okay, and then there is this remarkable result, initially from Snitman and extended by Meleard, Jourdain, and others, Villani, that if you have propagation of chaos, I will explain what is later, then you have this convergence result, which is that you compute the average of your, say for instance, that's your payoff applied to your calibrated model, so the one that follows this particle method here, it will converge as the number of particles goes to infinity to the price of the calibrated model, where now P, okay, is the density of the solution to my McKean equation. Okay, so P is actually solution to my nonlinear Fokker-Planck PD. Okay, so actually you see that in the large n limit, you can approximate the nonlinear low-dimensional Fokker-Planck PDE by a higher-dimensional linear Fokker-Planck PDE. And it's quite funny because typically in physics they do the other way around. Okay, they have a system of plenty of particles, linear but like plenty of particles, and they will write a low-dimensional nonlinear PDE to describe the behavior of a typical particle. Here, we go the other way around. Okay, we start actually from a low-dimensional nonlinear PDE. That's the PDE that describes our calibrated model. And we actually go in large dimension to solve a large dimension linear problem to approximate our initial problem. Yeah. So it's going the other way around. Okay, that's the seminal paper by McKean, where he precisely described this propagation of chaos. I will describe it later. And that's here, okay, Katz describing the first known instance of this phenomenon called it the propagation of chaos. So that's a term coined by Katz in 1960. So an archetypal example of this McKean SDE is the McKean-Vlasov SDE, okay, where the drift and diffusion coefficient, okay, are simply unconditional expectation of some functions B and sigma. Okay, so instead of having just a function B of T and X, you have a function B of T, X, and Y, and you average over Y being, you average over the current marginal distribution of X. So that means that the particle method would read exactly like this. Okay, so for each particle, you have your xi, and then you average over the y, you take the average against the empirical distribution. So this one has all the xj's. So of course, this is just equivalent, because this is just a sum of Dirac masses with weight y over n. This is just equivalent to this PDE here, where of course the interaction between xi and xj is apparent, because it's really written, you have a function of xi and xj, and you sum over all the j's. So that's all the interaction between particles. Okay. In our case, so the case of, say, stochastic local volatility models, okay, so for simplicity, here with deterministic rates and dividend, so what we know is that we want to estimate. Okay, the nonlinearity only comes through the conditional expectation of instantaneous variance, so instantaneous stochastic variance, AT squared, given the spot value. Okay, so if we blindly apply the particle method, that means that we replace the true PT by this empirical distribution. Okay, and because it's a conditional expectation, okay, it should read like this. But of course, that makes no sense, because there is no, in your sample of n path, there is no path such that the spot at time t will be exactly equal to s. Okay, so of course, what you have to do is, instead of taking like exactly this Dirac mass, you just use a kernel, okay, to approximate the conditional expectation. So that's basically non-parametric regression, of course. If you have at squared here and st, and if you have plenty of points, so that's the scatter plot that you get when you simulate your particle method. Mm-hmm. But of course, if you want to estimate the expectation of AT squared given that ST is equal to S, you see that I didn't cheat. There is not, of course, a single point exactly on that line. That's sure. So what you do is just you use, for instance, kernel regression, okay, where you will use a weighting scheme using this kernel, okay, based on the distance, for instance, here to S, and you will average the AT squared value weighted by the distance to the S value. And that's exactly this expression here. Here it's inverted because it's 1 over. But for the estimation of the conditional expectation of A squared given the spot. Okay, so the particle method actually is just approximating this conditional expectation using kernel regression. Okay, and then once you have done this, so basically at each time t, okay, you have simulated 1,000 paths, okay, so you have 1,000 pairs S and AT squared, you need to estimate the conditional expectation of AT squared given the spot. Non-parametric regression. Okay, we'll give you, something like this. Of course, you have to decide the bandwidth, the size of the bandwidth, and all that.
Yes.
Okay, you have computed.
May I ask one question at this moment? You touched on a think important point, and you said you have to decide the bandwidth.
Yeah.
Isn't that the moment you really decide what is the level of optimization or regularization you are doing?
So first we have a rule of thumb for the choice of the bandwidth, which works quite well, very well. And I just multiply this rule of thumb by a dimensionless number, 1, 2, 3, and you can check, and of course you have to do this all the time, you can check the accuracy of your calibration by pricing vanilla options in your calibrated model at the end and compare with the vanilla smine. Okay. And actually, I've never met examples where this would fail. Enfin, I have met examples in the case where vol is very large. I will talk about it later. But in typical market conditions and for reasonable values of the parameters, I've never found situations where the choice of the size of the bandwidth is a problem. And so actually what I do in practice is if you want to automatize it, so maybe actually machine learning can help for this automatic choice of the bandwidth. Otherwise what I do is just in case I have to automate this, I just try 3 or 4 sizes of the bandwidth and take the one that realizes that minimizes the distance to the market implied vol. But you're right, just to finish, you're right that the crucial point numerically is to fine-tune the bandwidth. But again, we have a rule of thumb, typically. So basically the bandwidth, I can give it to you. Typically will be, some dimensionless number. And it's going to be some volatility level. So it can be the variance swap vol, at the Monet vol, sigma zero square root of t, typically, when you are time, when you are time small t. So that's typically the standard deviation, of your s. And then n to the power minus 1/5. This comes from the Nadaraya-Watson. It's a trade-off between bias and variance when you estimate densities. And so the optimal size of the bandwidth for the Nadaraya-Watson estimator is typically n to the power minus 1/5. Anyway, if you use n just a few thousand, it decays very slowly. So it depends actually much on your kappa, and that's where the kappa. So if it's Gaussian, typically kappa would be 1.06. So that's Silverman's rules. And so typically I use a 1, 2, 3 here for the kappa. Yeah, Rafael.
It's related, the condition, the fact that the conditioning by S equals S as zero measure is exactly related to the fact that that specifying the volatility in a local volatility model gives you a measure which is not, changing the volatility basically are not equivalent measures.
Yeah.
But as soon as you have a stochastic volatility model, then choosing one distribution of volatility versus another distribution of volatility, these are equivalent measures. And in fact, truly, you don't need to specify exactly ST equals S. So, you do it. That's why you have a bandwidth which allows to do it, because basically, in fact, you're in a setting where you could vary S as much as almost, it's a density estimation, it's a 2D density estimation in the S sigma space. And so that's why you have a bandwidth for which it doesn't change basically. You could
it's like, you know, in the plane you have two dimensions too. So there is no reason why being completely specific on one dimension, whereas in fact you have you have uncertainty on the two directions. So you are just allowing S to be as uncertain as sigma. That's we'll discuss that, but I will show you. I mean, okay. I see exactly the geometric reason why.
Okay. I'll be glad to discuss
you can have that.
Okay, so now that you have, so you're at time t, you have estimated this conditional expectation. Okay, so you plug it here, and that gives you your the estimated leverage function at time t. Okay. And once you have it at time t, then you can use it to simulate from t to t plus delta t, and so on and so forth. Okay, so that's the particle method. Okay, so if you just look at this equation, it looks actually very bad because you have n paths, okay? And for each of the paths, you need to estimate the leverage function. And for each estimation of the leverage function here, you have sums of n terms. So it looks like it's n squared, the computation. But n is the number of Monte Carlo paths in your Monte Carlo, so typically it's going to be 10,000. So n squared is going to be 100 million. You don't want that, okay? It's going to take forever. So it's crucial to design acceleration techniques. Okay? Make sure that this works as fast, maybe you say as slow, but actually for me as fast as a standard Monte Carlo method. But actually that's, yes?
Uh-huh. Like
sure.
And then
you get the leverage function. So the question was, okay, I solve this, and then what happens?
Yeah.
What happens is, for each time t, I will have my estimated leverage function. So I store it somewhere. I store my leverage function at time t. Okay. And then after, when I want to price exotic options, path-dependent payoffs, I will use my calibrated model.
So this calibrates the model?
This calibrates the model. I will show you pictures.
But
I hope they will
convince
you.
It's like magic, right?
It's like magic. You will see it. It's that I told you from at the very beginning, it was the best scientific surprise of my life. It works like that. No, really. It's like standard Monte Carlo, and it calibrates perfectly to the smile. Yes? No, that's true. That exactly like local vol will guarantee that you're calibrated to the market smile, but it's not guaranteeing you that if you hedge according to the local vol model, you will be happy with the hedge. Exactly the same. So that's, I'm completely okay with that remark. Yeah. Exactly same issue as for the local vol model, and actually any model, if you think of it. It's not designed for optimal hedge here. It's really pricing.
Actually, Guillaume has a measure of model risk, which consists precisely of running on real market dynamics the SDE, and to see whether there is a drift. So basically, you come to the point where your hedge is efficient. Precisely, if you have calibrating the volatility of the volatility and the correlation with the spot, etc., to something that corresponds to reality.
Yeah, I agree. Yeah, and that's so, the problem. That corresponds to reality.
And he has made a whole theory of measuring model risk by the drift of the. Yeah. So if you use a stochastic local volatility model with deterministic volatility, you will see it drifting because actually the true volatility is stochastic. So you will pay for the hedge.
Yeah.
But if your stochastic volatility model fits match the real volatility of the market,
I agree. But that's
then you get the stuff.
I completely
agree
with you.
There is an exact answer
to
that question.
How do you fit the?
Same question as Black-Scholes. You know how to set the volatility to get the right drift and the right price of the option. It's the same thing, but you just push it at a step forward.
Yeah, yeah. But that's the thing that we have no meta model, on about like how No, I agree. So to answer your question, imagine.
At some point, markets have statistics,
Yeah, but so, okay, so what I say, so imagine that actually, okay, I will just take 30 seconds to answer your question. If you have chosen a stochastic volatility 80, or actually, as I believe, maybe a path-dependent volatility 80, because you like it, because it generates a nice joint dynamics for spot and implied volatilities that you observe in the market. And that calibrates quite well, approximately to the SMILE, then you actually expect your leverage function to be something around one that does not change too much. So it will not modify the dynamics too much. So basically, of course, when you multiply by the leverage function, it will change your dynamics, but you expect that it will not be modified too much. And so in the end, you get a model that still has the correct dynamics that you like, that will allow for a good hedge because you believe that that's how the markets behave. And on top of that, that will be calibrated to the... So that's also what I like with the particle method and this thing, is that you can also reconcile calibration, so historical calibration, calibration from the past, if you want, observing like how markets behave, how volatility reacts depending on recent returns on the index, and implied calibration using option prices. You can actually do both at the same time here. Okay, so going back to the acceleration techniques, we really have to get rid of this n squared, okay? And remember, so the first n is because you have n particles, and you want to compute the leverage function for each of the n particles, and then the second n is because you have sums of n terms for each estimation of the leverage function. But actually, for the first n, it's stupid. You don't need to estimate the leverage function for all the, 10,000 paths. Because you have 10,000 paths, you will estimate for a spot being equal to 98.92, and then for the spot equal to 98.93, and then 0.94. Actually, you will repeat plenty of times the same calculation. The only thing you need to do is actually to estimate the leverage function on a grid of spot values. You need to have like enough points in your grid, and then you interpolate and extrapolate. Okay? It's usually enough. Okay? So instead of estimating the leverage function at each and every simulated spot Si, and there are, say, 10,000 of them, I actually compute sigma n of Ts for a grid of values of S, say 30 or 50 of them. And then I interpolate and extrapolate. So the first n, instead of being 10,000, will become 30 or 50, okay? So that's, of course, an incredible speed up in the computations. And also for the second n, which is this one here, actually you see that plenty, so that corresponds to this computation here, the parametric, sorry, non-parametric regression. Of course, all those points here, you can ignore them. They are too far from S, okay? So actually the sum over n terms are not sums over n terms. They are just sums over, I don't know, maybe it's like 10% of the terms or whatever, depending on the bandwidths that are around the S value. Okay, and so, for instance, in C++, what you can do is just disregard the Monte Carlo path for which the S value is far from the S in your grid. Okay, for instance, if the kernel value is less than some thresholds. Okay. So in practice, that means that you would need to sort particles according to the spot value, but the cost of sorting, which is just n log n, is actually more than compensated by the acceleration in the evaluation of the sum. So instead of having sums of n terms here, you would just have sums of maybe 10% of the n. So it speeds up considerably the computation. Okay. And so that's why, in the end, you get Monte Carlo method that is as fast as a standard Monte Carlo method. Okay. And that's how it would read here. Okay, you start with your leverage function, which is just the local vol at time zero divided by the initial value. So alpha is the initial value of your stochastic vol. Okay. You simulate up to time t1. At time t1, okay, you have a graph like this one. You estimate, you sort the particle according to spot value in that case, okay, and you find the smallest and the largest index for which the kernel is more than some threshold eta. Okay, eta can be zero if you use a kernel that has compact support, And then you compute this local volatility leverage function, okay? But only for the S in your grid, so maybe 30 points. And here you have sums that are not sums of n terms, but less. And then, so here it's at time t1, okay? And you interpolate and extrapolate in S, okay? Maybe using cubic spline, okay? And extrapolate typically flat for the conditional expectation. And then that gives you the leverage function at time t1, which is the one that you will use between t1 and t2 for your simulation up to time t2. And then at time t2, you're again in the same situation, and you loop until you reach maturity. Actually, I must say that if you use MATLAB or Python, they have like very good packages, because this is just matrix vector multiplications, right? So they have like very efficient matrix vector multiplications. So you don't need actually to do the sort thing, okay? It's actually very efficient to do it, to do the sums of, because it's very efficient matrix vector multiplication. Any question? Okay. Adding stochastic rates, so we have seen
did
that.
Did you try the
who are you?
You know, the Dalmoral method of particle, you know, you're not doing any type of important sampling here.
No, there's no important sampling here. It could be potentially extremely.
Yeah, exactly. Wings, I was thinking that, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, you're right. Because in the wings, of course, you don't have many paths there, so it's hard to estimate correctly the leverage function. But using important sampling, yeah, so I actually read Delmora's paper, like the genealogical algorithm, but, I don't remember how they call it, but I have not implemented it, yeah. But, yeah, it would definitely be useful. So we have seen that when the rates are stochastic, okay, we just have one extra term, which is here, plus, of course, the discount factor that's now stochastic, okay? Okay, so we have seen this. That also means that if you write the thing in the T forward measure, okay, the one associated to the bond maturing at small t, then actually it reads this way, okay, where actually the discount factor, you know, goes out of the expectation and because it becomes the bond price. And of course, you change the measure from P, so that's the usual risk-neutral measure associated to the money market account, to this PT measure, which is the forward measure. Note that the problem never happens in practice, but you see that it could be mathematically that, okay, maybe one thing, by the way. Even imagine that actually A is always 1. So it's just local volatility model, but with stochastic rates.
I have a question. Why are stochastic rates important?
It can be important, of course, if you have long-dated options. I agree that, OK?
Yeah.
It can also be important if you have rates showing up explicitly in the payoff.
Uh-huh. Make it discrete.
What do you mean?
That means that what you, the steps that you did before, uh-huh. Now that we know the steps, uh-huh. To explain it,
uh-huh.
How do you discretize that? And so you make it, you know, all
what do you mean discretizing?
Discretizing means
in time?
Finance is discrete.
In time or in discrete?
In time and space. There's no continuous time, there's no continuous drives, there's no degree of volatility.
So you mean just using the option prices that are observed?
Use the algo.
Uh-huh.
Now tell me how you take this algo. I'm not joking. How do you take this algo and you build a discrete numerical scheme stable?
But that's a discrete, but somehow that discrete in time.
Yeah.
That's somehow discrete in also, somehow in spots because I just use a discrete grid of stock here. Yeah.
No, it's because you need to, you know, I like to get numerical answers to numerical problems.
That's a numerical answer. You'll see. I know. I really hope to convince you. Yeah, that's a numerical answer. I will.
Convince me with a picture.
Yeah, I will. In like 3 minutes.
Okay.
I swear. Yeah, I'm not spending much time on the stochastic
Marco,
weights.
Marco, don't worry, Marco. Marco, you were here for the second half of the presentation this morning by your neighbor. Don't you think rate were sufficiently stochastic to justify the fact that you have stochastic rate in this equation?
I would say, please give me a break. I need a break. Yeah. You know, you have a model that's really complicated. The rates are, it's an anecdote.
I don't want to spend too much time on the rates. Okay. The main message here is that the particle method is robust to, because if you were to use PDEs, okay, for instance here, because you have a nonlinear PDE, the Fokker-Planck PDE, if you have two factors driving your stochastic volatility, if the rates are stochastic, anyway you have the spot, so that you will already be in dimension four. I mean, how can you do that? But here it's fine, you don't care. It's just Monte Carlo, it's just one.
It's so that's, because he's that's using the word point. Rate, it's a drift. Which is stochastic, and it's not necessarily just interest rates.
Okay, and so my point, I will let you continue your discussion during the break in 5 minutes, that here, actually, even if you just have, so AT is one, you just have local volatility, but you have stochastic rates, it's not easy to calibrate the local volatility. You cannot use, and you should not use, the Dupuyer formula, because part of the of the volatility of the forward comes from the volatility of the rates. Okay, and you see that imagine that the rates are uncorrelated with the spot. Okay, so the Brownian motion that drives the rates is not correlated with the Brownian motion that drives the spot. Actually, this would not be zero because actually the rates R are the drift of S. So if you know that S is large, greater than K, that probably means that you used a large rate. So that means that this term would typically be positive, even if rates and spots are uncorrelated, the Brownian motion that drives them. So that means that you would remove, because there's a minus sign here, you would remove something positive. So actually the sigma, this would be 1, because A is equal to 1. So the sigma that you should use is sigma Dupuyer minus something. Okay, and that's true, because part of the volatility. But of course, if the rates, okay, so that was a sanity check. But of course, if the rates are negatively correlated with the spot, then that makes the thing more, this expectation could be negative, and then that means that you should use a larger volatility than the Dupuyer volatility. Okay. So that's all consistent. Anyway, I don't want to spend more time on the stochastic rates, except to tell you that there is this very funny thing here, and that's linked to your remark on the wings, how to estimate the leverage function on the wings. We have here, you see this term that we add, which is actually typically 0/0 when the strike is very large or when the strike is very small. When the strike is very large, it's clear because the indicator is becoming zero. And this is the density of the spot, so when the strike is very large, it's zero. So it's going to be 0/0. So numerically, it's going to be crazy. Okay, you're going to have things like that. You don't like that. You don't want that. And when strike is actually very small, actually because if R0 is taken like this one, which is the natural choice, then the expectation of this expectation becomes zero as well, because R0 will be the expectation of RT under the forward measure. So it, again, it's going to be, and this is the density for very small strikes, it's zero as well. So it's going to be also 0/0. So what we have done with Pierre is to write this new term that you see involves an unconditional expectation using the Malliamin calculus, so the Clark-Ocon formula, okay, and that now expresses this term as it's not a ratio anymore, and it's just like the integral of these conditional expectations. And it's quite funny because usually people use Malliavin calculus because they have a conditional expectation. It's complicated, the conditional expectation. So they want to write it using unconditional expectations, okay, using the integration by parts and the Malliavin weights. Okay. But here it's actually the other way around. So we have this unconditional expectation and we don't like it because it's 0/0, because you have this particular denominator here. And actually using Malliavin calculus, okay, and we actually write it using a conditional expectation, and that smoothes the things really incredibly. So we actually call it disintegration by parts because it's going the other way around. Okay, and that works really well. Now, when you want to estimate the leverage function in the wings, you get something smooth. I mean, and that's the first time in my life as a quant that I see a useful application of Mellian calculus, which doesn't mean that it never happens, or I don't know, but really in my life it was the first time, and I was very happy to experiment this. Okay, I don't want to say more. This is just the same slide for stochastic dividend yield, but because I'm already anticipating Marco's question about why dividend yields are stochastic are so important, it's not really so important. Maybe it's important when you price dividend swaps and all that, but here it's just to show you that you get also a McInnes D for this equation. One point that I wanted to raise is that you see that it never happens in practice, but mathematically you see that it could be that this term that you remove may be so big that actually the right-hand side becomes negative. And then that's not good, because then you need, this is a sigma squared, okay? Never happens in practice, okay? But could be, okay? Then that would just mean that those local stochastic volatility model here with stochastic rates would not be consistent with market data. That's all what it would say. It wouldn't tell you that you have arbitrage or whatever. It would just tell you that market data is not consistent with those models. But again, never happens in practice. We will see problems when I talk of a local correlation in the second part of the talk. Okay, the pictures. First, it's precisely just local vol plus stochastic rates. Very simple case. But already I have mentioned that it's not so easy to calibrate the local volatility when the rates are stochastic. You really have to do something. I've taken the Holy model for the rates, 1% volatility for the rates, which corresponds to like 6 bips per day. Positive correlation, 40% between the DAX here, the index is the DAX, and the rates. Okay, I just use 1,000 particles for my calibration. Really, not much. Okay, not many particles. And then, okay, once I have calibrated my model, so I have stored my leverage function, and then I price using my calibrated model. So I use more like 32,000 Monte Carlo path, so that's in a second independent Monte Carlo run, and this one is just a standard Monte Carlo. I have already calibrated my model, and I want to check, and then I price the vanilla options in my calibrated model, and I want to check that it corresponds to the market prices. That's because it was designed for this. So these are the smiles for maturity 4 years on the left and 10 years on the right. Okay, because it's more easy to see on 10 years, I will just look at the right picture. Okay, so the market is in green here. And you see that actually, even so that's 1,000, 4,000 particles. They are actually perfectly calibrated. Maybe not in the wings, because you know, in the wings you don't have many particles. So depends on how you have extrapolated your conditional expectations, you know, once you are in the particle method.
No calibration mean?
So no calibration mean when you just use the Dupierre formula. Imagine you were a bit distracted and you forgot that the rates were stochastic, and you just applied the Dupierre formula. So you use this Dupierre formula for the local vol, but with stochastic rates. Actually, because the correlation is positive here, so you see that you would get a smile that is larger than the market smile. So that means that indeed the sigma, the local volatility that you should use is smaller than the Dupierre, should be smaller than the Dupierre volatility. But this is just to show you the error in bips. It's just, you know, up to 10 bips. And this is up to 10 years. Yeah, by the way, let me tell you that this is 4 seconds up to 10 years. Okay, 4 seconds to calibrate up to 10 years.
So do you have, in your example, market data, and you're fitting the market data, or you have calibrated the market and then generated data?
So first I have market data.
Okay.
I interpolate and extrapolate the implied volatilities.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Then I compute the leverage function using the particle method. And finally, I reprice call options in my calibrated model, compute the implied volatilities in the calibrated model. So that's the blue and red curves here. And I compare with the market data.
Okay, yeah.
And that's that works super well.
Yeah, so you're basically interpolating the market data from the beginning.
From the beginning, as I discussed.
How
from
do
the
you
beginning.
Know, are you using some way of making sure you don't get
arbitrage? Of course. That was a big part of the, at SocGen, of course, we spent quite a lot of time,
making sure, both
like a butterfly arbitrage and calendar spread arbitrage. Okay. Yeah, absolutely. That's very important because otherwise you get a negative local vol, squared of the local vols, and so this is taken care of. So each time you have interpolated and extrapolated your implied vols in such a way that it's arbitrage free, so that means that when you compute the local volatility squared, it's positive. So no calendar arbitrage.
What's the delta T? The
Delta T that you use.
The time step.
How many time steps for 4 years?
I would say one per day.
So for 4 years, it's like thousands of time steps.
Yeah, it would be 250 per year.
You do the smoothing every day, and then you...
The thing is that, we interpolate... then that's another issue. But we interpolate implied volatilities in such a way... So you look like maturity by maturity. Okay, you want to have a positive density, if you want. And then, so that's for the butterfly spread arbitrage. And then for calendar arbitrage, we know that sigma squared t, where sigma is the implied vol, as a function of log moniness, have to be increasing in maturity, so they should not cross. So we make sure that the extrapolations are in...
And everything has to be smooth.
And it has to be smooth, of
course. Everything
has to be
smooth, otherwise.
That's a lot of work. But
it's a lot of work.
That's a full, that's huge work. And I'm here another part where I'm taking the result of that full work. Yeah, but I agree. You could have a completely different point of view and say, no, I just want to work with just those 37 market data points.
So reproducing this is not easy.
I mean, for the DAX or for the S&P 500, you have so many options. That's what I say. It would be because any reasonable interpolation and extrapolation schemes would give you the same. When you deal with the DAX or the S&P, you have so many data points that maybe you will want to use cubic spline and somebody wants to use like another interpolation scheme, whatever. But in the end, you have so many points that it will. But of course, if you give me like some Turkish stock or whatever.
Not reproducing your numerical results, writing the code from scratch for a person like me. Like, if I MATLAB,
that would be a lot of work. Sure.
Very small point on top of that. If the Dupuy local volatility is given at every point, which means that someone has done the difficult part of the job of no arbitrage interpolation of implied vol, and the Dupuy local vol is given, implementing your particle method,
it's super easy. Yeah.
It's quick.
Yes, exactly.
If
you're able to generate a local volatility that you're happy with, meaning that it's decently calibrated to your data, then that's all you need to input in the particle method.
The other point, the other numerical point that you made about fast calculation of matrices, you have to realize that the end value, the estimated value of sigma through the kernel, is eventually a linear function of the input of the data points. So you can pre-calculate all the matrix, all the transformation matrix, which you can store. And then every time you have a new point that's coming, you just remap that, and that's a matrix that the pre-calculation of the matrix is stored once for all.
Interesting, yeah. Thanks for this. So I will take just 2 minutes to end up with the single asset case, showing the pictures, and that's all. So that's local volatility plus stochastic volatility. So I chose the Bergomi model for the stochastic volatility. Don't have to enter into details, but it's a two-factor stochastic volatility model that's basically driven by two Ornstein-Uhlenbeck. And here are the parameters. And again, it's like for 4 year and 10 year maturities. So you see you have more curve here. I will just quickly explain them. First, this light blue is the smile produced by the pure stochastic volatility model, if you do not multiply by the leverage function. Okay, so it's far from the market, which is in purple here. So you really need, in that case, the leverage function. Maybe you would. Okay, that's just on this numerical example. And then you have blue, red, and green are the result of the particle method. Again, the market is in purple. So, you don't see well, but maybe this is with 1,000 particles, 4,000 particles, it's a bit too low. But actually, even with 8,000 particles, 21 seconds, you're really good. That's the grid line. You're really good, maybe up to very far in the wings, okay? But you're calibrated extremely well to the market smile, okay? And you have an extra curve, which is the orange curve here. That was the best approximation available at the time for this problem. You see that's a problem in dimension 3 because you have two factors on the vol and one factor for the spot, okay? And that was an approximation that was derived by Pierre-Henri Labordère. And even around the money, you see it was not calibrating so well, okay? So, and the last picture here is when you mix everything, so local vol, stochastic rates, okay? So that would require solving a four-dimensional PD, okay? So good luck. So that's why here you don't have even an orange curve here because there was no approximation available at the time. And you see that again with like, this is 8,000 particles, okay, in 40 seconds, you're calibrating, so that's the green curve, you're calibrating very well to the market, which is in purple, only maybe in the wings. It's not clear because it depends on the extrapolation that you're using. And it's just like 40 seconds up to 10 years and like a perfect calibration, even with plenty of stochastic processing driving your market model. In the last minute for this first part, I really want to stress that here it's really remarkable because this calibration procedure involves no optimization at all. I think it's remarkable. And of course, like, you know, calibration is, okay, which method do you use to optimize? You could be stuck in local minima, calibration to the whole smile is imperfect. Here it's perfect calibration without any optimization because somehow we already know the solution. We have an explicit formula for the solution. Okay, and the fun part of it is that it's been an hour and a half that I've been talking, and maybe I've been talking about something that does not exist. Because we still have no proof of existence and uniqueness of the Makin SDE for this stochastic local vol calibration problem, my calibration problem. It's a very difficult problem. Many people much smarter than me
even,
have tried.
Even a weak solution?
I know, I'm talking of weak solution. Even weak solution, not the strong solution, just a weak solution.
It's not elliptic.
It's complicated because of the conditional expectation. Because you know the nonlinearity comes with the conditional expectation for two things, in the diffusive part. If you have unconditional expectation, that's fine. If you have conditional expectations in the drift, that's fine. Denis Talley has done this. If you have conditional expectation in the diffusive coefficient, it's very hard to prove existence and uniqueness. And the best result so far, I have a slide on it, is due to Benjamin Jourdain and Alexandre Zhu from last year. But it's still very partial because it's just a stochastic volatility process that takes a finite number of values.
But that's because it becomes
non-elliptic. It's more about the fact that you can. So then, it's not Lipschitz for the Wasserstein metric. and so you cannot use the fixed point algorithm, PCAR iterations and all that. So so for instance, I just tried for 350% vol of vol. Note that here I use like 200% vol of vol. It's a large vol of vol, but still it works. And that's not crazy because on equity markets, that's typically the values that you would use, 200% vol of vol. If I just push to 300. That's the vol of a very short-term vol, so the combination of the two. A very short-term vol would have a vol of 200%. Yeah, exactly. That would be like the vol of the VIX. Yeah. And if I push it up to 350%, actually, you will see that even with 32,000 particles around the money, we would not calibrate so well. Okay. And actually, I have done tests using PDEs, using Monte Carlo. I have read this paper by Bergel and Tachet, 2010. This recent paper by Jourdain and Zhu, that's the best results to date. And for all my personal experiences and the reading of those papers, it's quite clear that the answer is not black or white. There is existence and uniqueness up to a critical maturity, and at which point the solution blows up. Okay. So if the vol of vol is very small, then your critical maturity is very far, and you will never see it. Okay, and that's fine. So in the markets, you will never face a problem. But if the vol of vol is very large, okay, then your critical maturity is actually quite close to today. Okay, and that means that maybe it's in 6 months, and if you want the price, you know, calibrate up to 3 years, 4 years, then. Then you will have been passed beyond the critical point, and that's why your even for two-dimensional models, your PDE completely blows up. Yeah.
Can I ask one
question? Sure.
You know, I was actually wondering about that particular point, not now, but in the Bergomi model and everything, because you're doing exponentials of OUs,
uh-huh,
which have vols of about 100%.
Uh-huh.
And so forth. And now, for example, the exponential of that, like if you think about a e to the sigma dw plus 1/2 sigma squared dt, that's not even integrable. So you don't, if you stick that into a exponential martingale and try to compute the expectation, how do you deal with that? Is that
so? You have result. You actually have results about like is the spot a true martingale if you use like for instance log normal stochastic volatility. So if the correlation between spot and vol is negative, that's fine. If not, even if its correlation is zero, then it's actually not a true martingale and you have integrability problems. Here the problems that I mentioned are even on top of that because they're really due to the non-linearity in the SDE. And actually, I'm talking of that, but you know, with the hands, because we still don't have a precise. I mean, we have a few precise results, but that concern only limited cases. I see that George is stopping me, so I will stop. Yeah, non-exempt, so it's still unclear and all that. But I want to finish the single asset. Okay, I can continue after. That's fine. Let me. No. But because it would be nice maybe to stop. Between the single asset case and multi asset, but I have a few slides on path dependent vol, so I will start with those. Okay.
Well, okay. Let's thank Julien Guillon again. Thank you very much, Julien. So, in the